Welcome to the module 1. This module 1 is divided into two sessions. So today I will be discussing on session 1, which is on introduction to optimization. This session includes introduction to optimization, basically the definition, and with the help of an example, we will understand why we call them as a search and optimization. Thereafter, we will discuss some real world applications. Those have been solved using EC techniques or evolutionary computing techniques, and with that we will be moving to the properties of practical optimization problem. So since there are different characteristics or properties available, looking at those properties we generally decide what kind of algorithm we have to use it. So therefore we will be going through all those properties one by one. Thereafter we will discuss the problem formulation, so the generalized formulation, the mathematical equations, how to find the variables, constraints, the type of constraints, objective functions and variable bounds. So we will discuss them one by one, and thereafter we will give some remarks on numerical optimization techniques, and finally we will move forward to evolutionary computation techniques. So let us begin with introduction to optimization here. Now before we start, let us find what is the meaning of search and optimization. If we define it, it is a task of searching for a set of decision variable which would minimize or maximize objective function subjected to satisfying constraint. So let us understand this definition with the help of an example. So the example is given here. So on the right hand side, you can see that we have a function called fxy, which is sin x and cos y. On the left hand side, if you see that, we want to maximize this function. So the problem is we want to maximize the function sin x and a cos y. Now this particular function is made of two variables, x and a y, and using x and a y we defined a function. So it is called as objective function. Now let us look at the green point. So generally when we solve a problem, so we don't know where is the optima. So optimization algorithms start with a random point, so that we are referring it as a initial guess. Now the green point in the xy plane is the initial guess for us. Once we find the initial guess, we calculate the objective function value. So if you look at this line and if you find this another green point on the surface, that signifies what is the objective function value. So once we find it out, then at this current point in the xy plane, we try to find out in which direction we should move so that our objective function should improve. Now here if we say should improve, it means that the objective function should increase. Since it is a maximization problem, objective function should keep on increasing in that direction. So with the local idea or some rule, we find say direction S1, as you can see here. When we are moving along that direction, we get a first point, say P1. This P1 is the point which is better than the green point, and this point if it is better, it means that it has a larger objective function value than the green point. So once we find this point P1, again looking at the local information or the search direction, we move in another direction, say S2. Once we are moving on S2, we will get another point, say P2. So this P2, we can calculate the objective function, and when we compare the function value at point P2 with P1, so the P2 is better in terms of objective function. It means that our objective function is improving. Thereafter, again we will move in the direction, say S3, and we will get a point, say P3. And finally, going in another direction, we will get an optimum solution. So the overall process, if you understand it, you can realize that what we are doing is we are searching for a set of decision variable by moving from say green point to the point 1, then point 2, then point 3, and finally reaching to the optimal solution. So this whole process is defined as a search and optimization, where we look for an optimal value of x and a y that will be maximizing the function, which you can see as a black dot. Now let us move towards the scope of an optimization. Let us begin with the automotive design. Now in this particular application, the aim was to find the best combination of a material with best engineering to provide faster, lighter, more fuel efficient and safer vehicle. So having this particular aim, the scientists and the researchers, they use genetic algorithm with the models, the available models, and they try to optimize their car design. So what they found is that if they are going to use any optimization or evolutionary computation techniques, they can actually save lot of years in a laboratory working with polymers, wind tunnels and other equipment to find what could be the optimal design for a racing car. So their achievement is that they can find the solution, the optimal design of the car, much quicker and more efficiently by computer modeling using genetic algorithm. So here you realize that when we are performing lot of experiments, it requires lot of time as well as funds. So both of them will be required to come up with a new racing design. However, if we couple our computer models with genetic algorithm or any evolutionary algorithm, this will give us a solution on which the designers will work on it and can further improve the design. The second application is the engineering design, where the objective is to optimize the structural and operational design of buildings, factories, machine, etc. Now this application is widely used in various applications, whether it is mechanical engineering or civil engineering, electrical engineering or chemical engineering. We always try to find out the engineering, the optimal engineering design. So the application is varied. It can start from heat exchanger to the robot gripping, satellite booms, building trusses, flywheels, turbines, mechanism and etc. So since there is a wide applications, so what you will realize that with the help of computer and an optimization algorithm, we can find an optimal solution or the design for our engineering problems. Another interesting example you can find is in the robotics. So here aim is the intelligence and learning in robotics. So the learning behind learning in the robotics can be done with the help of optimization. So there is a lot of scope here. So these two scientists, long back in 2003, they use genetic algorithms for intelligent control of robotic system. With this, they can find the application in robot path planning, vision, speech and behavior. So it's a very interesting example where GA will guide a robot to learn and apply intelligence to do the task for which the robots are assigned. This is another interesting application on evolvable hardware. We have to create an electronic circuits created by GA model. So these scientists, they work on this problem. They use GA for evolving some of the hardwares. That is also long back in 2006. Now the application of such kind of approach is they can come up with the new hardware, self-configurable electronic system. So you may realize that evolutionary computation may give you some kind of a design which may look simple, but it is not still available with us. So some new designs, simple designs can be evolved by the evolutionary computation. So what are the advantages? Since we are working on computer models, we are using GA to optimize it, we can have a rapid circuit design. The another application, which is a very well-known application, is the traveling salesman problem. This problem is known to many people, where the aim is to find the shortest route for the salesman. So let's look at into it. Now here you can see that there are many dots are given. So the problem is defined as the salesman has to start at a one particular node. He has to visit all the nodes just one, and finally it should come back to the original node. So within this condition we have to find what could be the shortest route for the salesman. So long back in 1996, this author has used genetic algorithm for solving the TSP problems. Now application of solving the TSP we can find in routing and scheduling. We can find the application in transportation problems, travel trip, traffic, shipment routing, production planning, and so many other applications. Now what you can see here is the given example has some number of nodes. Suppose when we are solving a real world problem, when we have more number of nodes, in that case GA will help you to give you a desirable solution for the shortest route for a salesman. Coming to a very interesting application, which is optimized telecommunication and routing. Now here the aim is dynamic and anticipatory routing of circuits for telecommunication network. So this study has been taken by these researchers and applied in one of the cities. What they found is when they include any evolutionary computation technique in their formulation, they can achieve the optimized placement and routing of cell tower for the best coverage. So for example, in a city with a lot of population, then how we are going to place those towers in the city so that everyone should get the desired signals. Now you may be realizing that in some portion of the city which may be highly dense population, and in other part of the city there may be the scarce population. So in that case, how we are going to put those towers? So since it is applied in practical, what these authors found that, so the overall advantage is they can reduce the cost of the project, overall cost of a project to put those towers in the city, as well as they achieved a uniform demand distribution among the various service sections. Coming to the data mining, as you know that data mining is a very important field right now. It is because we have lot of data that is generated either from the machines or it is coming from some applications, etc. Now the very first application in the data mining is the regression. Regression means that we have a set of a data and we try to find out the best fit curve. Now here the optimization will help you to find out the user defined parameters that will be controlling the best fit curve for the given data. As you can see in the figure, this particular best fit curve can be used for parametric optimization, or it can be used for prediction, or it can be used for prognosis as well. Now here it is important that when we are performing some parametric optimization, the overall aim is if we can predict something that is for unknown value of the input variable, then we don't have to perform so many experiments. So we can save those experiments, we can save some fund so that this regression can help you to predict what could be the values for the set of input parameters without performing the experiments. Another application you can find in classification. Now classification, as an example shown here, it's a binary classification. So when we are dividing these dots in a green and a black dots, so our aim here is to demark them so that we can use this demarcation for finding what should be the, what is the condition of our machine or what is the status of our disease. So this classification also need an optimization, so we have to solve it, and that will give us a good accuracy in classification. As you know, then this kind of a binary classification can help us to tell whether the machine is working fine or not, or the person has this disease or not. Another good application of optimization you can find in clustering, where different varieties of the data are put into different clusters. So the application of the clustering you can find in pattern recognition as well as in image processing. So data mining need optimization, and for solving that we need efficient optimization algorithms. Now in this slide you can find that there are various applications which has the scope of an optimization. Since these applications are complex and large in nature, so we need some algorithm that can solve these problems. So evolutionary computation can be helpful, or maybe other algorithm which is flexible enough to solve such kind of a problems which are large and complex. Although this particular list looks like a big list, but it is still not complete. When you search, you will find there are so many applications apart from what we discuss right now. There is a lot of application where there is a scope of an optimization. With this introduction on the application, we are moving towards the properties of practical optimization problem. So when we say a real world problem is large, complex, then what are the properties there exist with the practical optimization problems? So let us begin with non-differentiable functions. Now non-differentiable function, as you can see from both the figure, so the first figure on the left hand side says that if we plot y is equals to mod of x, so at x is equals to 0, function is non-differentiable. Similarly, if we look the right hand side figure, we have a function which is cube root of x, which is also non-differentiable at x is equals to 0. The issue with non-differentiable function is that if we look for the optimization method that need gradient information, we cannot use it. Coming to the second property, it's a discontinuous function. Looking at the figure of the discontinuous function, you can see that since the functions are discontinuous, optimization algorithm may stuck in one of the portion and may not reach to the global optimum. And that is a big challenge for an optimization algorithm to solve such kind of discontinuous function. The another application which you can find is the discontinuous search space. Now the discontinuous search space, as you can see in the figure, there are different values of x are given. It means that for a given problem, these x values are allowed. You cannot take any random value of x between this range. So the problem is the optimization algorithm has to find a way so that they can evaluate the objective function, they can search for the new points by looking only for the desired or the discrete value of x. Now in the given example, we have only 5 x values, but in real you may get a very large set of discrete x values, and by finding which set of x value is going to give me an optimum solution, it's going to be a challenging task. Now mixed variable problem. There are so many optimization problem exist in the literature that needs different types of different types of variables. For example, it can has binary, it can has discrete, or it can has a combination of these two with the real number. So one of the application, say in electrical engineering, is a unit commitment problem where the problem is mentioned as a binary as well as the real number. So the unit commitment problem involves both of them. Suppose if we want to design a gear, so the designing a gear involves real number, but the number of a teeth includes the integer numbers. So therefore this kind of a problem where we have multiple types of a variable, then it poses lot of challenges to the optimization algorithm to find an optimum solutions. Coming to the multimodal functions, these kind of functions are very popular. Why? Because at different values of x, you will get the optimum value of fx. Now look at this function here. Here we have x1, x2 and x3. These are the three places. If we are going to maximize the function, then these three points are the optimum solution. In general, when we solve such kind of a problem, our optimization algorithm will give you one of the points. But since these points may be useful in some designing of some product, or it may be used in engineering application, or it can be involved in a strategic decision making. So, we want to know what are these points x1, x2 and x3 where there is a same objective function which is maximum right now. So, this poses a difficulty for optimization algorithm to find all these points for a given problem. So, as you maybe you can acknowledge here that when we have a objective function, we don't know how many multimodal points will be there. So, the task is even more difficult because sometimes we may explore few points but not all of them. Coming to the another property which is called robust solution. Now, looking at the figure, suppose we want to maximize the function now. So, if we maximize, it's very clear the optimization algorithm should give us x1. Now, we can take this x1, we can design something, we can take some strategic decision based on that. Now, you know that if there is a small change in a x1 value, the objective function will reduce drastically. So, since it is going to be reduced drastically, so this point is very sensitive. So, if we are going to take a decision based on x1, this is going to be a problem for us in a future. So, what we can do is, rather than finding the point x1, we may look for a point say x2 which is kind of a stable. Even if there is a small change in the x2 values, the objective function should not change much. So, therefore, we look for a robust solution like x2 as compared to x1. But optimization algorithm doesn't know, so that's why finding such kind of a solution is a challenging task. Coming to the reliable solutions. Now, reliable solution, first of all, we have to see that there are two lines which with the hashed pattern. Now, these two lines, one is a straight line, another is a curve. So, these two lines represents the constraints. Now, suppose if we are going to solve this problem without considering anything, a simple optimization problem, you can find there is a deterministic optimum. So, this deterministic optimum is the solution if we solve this problem. However, in the real world application, what you will realize that the set of variables which we take, that can have certain uncertainty. So, because of that uncertainty, this deterministic solution will become infeasible. So, the task is how we can find a reliable solution as shown in the figure by using the optimization algorithm. So, this poses a difficulty for our algorithm since the x1 and x2 variables are uncertain. Now, putting all those properties in a one particular slide, you will realize that our function can be non-differentiable. So, the method which need gradient information may not be useful for solving such kind of a problem. It can be a discontinuous function or a search space. There also the optimization algorithms which requires that the search space should be continuous, that cannot be used. Similarly, discrete search space. Now, handling this discrete search space is a big challenge. So, we have to find a good algorithm that can solve such kind of a problem. Moving to the mixed variable, as I gave you an example of unit commitment problem or say gear design problem, or it can be a pressure vessel design problem. So, in these problems, what you will realize that it requires the binary variables, as well as we need sometime discrete variable along with the real variables. So, when you have a combination of such kind of a variable, solving those problems are really difficult. Coming to the large dimensional problem, it means that the number of variable is too large. So, solving a practical problem having that can have lot many variables make a problem difficult to solve. Similarly, we can have lot many constraint for a given problem. Nonlinear constraints. So, this nonlinear constraint, it can be nonlinear constraint as well as functions. Now, the nonlinear constraint will pose a difficulty in a way that some particular portion may be will be a trap where our optimization algorithm can stuck. Those traps generally refer as local optimum solutions. So in that case, these non-linearities will make a challenge that if optimization algorithm converge to the local optimum point, how we can come out and find the global optimum point. Multimodal function, as we have defined, that there are different points where we can get the optimal objective function value. Since we don't know what are those points, how an algorithm can find all those points so that we can analyze those points in our decision making. Then comes multi-objective. As our course is divided into two parts, single objective optimization and multi-objective optimization. So multi-objective optimization means when we are solving a problem which has more than one objective, it means that we have more number of solutions which are optimal. Those solutions are generally referred as Pareto optimal solutions. So can our algorithm give those Pareto optimal solutions? So that is a challenge for us. Now, uncertainty in the variable, as we discussed in the previous slide. So this uncertainty can make our optimum solution infeasible. So that's why we are looking for a reliable solution under the uncertainty in the variables. Some problems are computationally expensive. Let us take an example. There is a problem called topology optimization. Now, if it is topology optimization of a structure, it involves optimization plus finite element simulations. We know that finite element simulation requires time. So as we need, for example, say 5 minutes to get one simulation of finite element, and if we have to run our optimization algorithm say for 100 iterations, so basically we need 500 minutes to solve it, which is a big number. So these kind of a problem where we are including some simulations or the function evaluation itself is very computationally expensive. So those problems are going to be difficult to solve them in a limited time. Last but not the least, it's a multidisciplinary problems where we take the principles, concepts from different disciplines like mechanical, electrical, civil engineering, chemical engineering, putting together, and then we are solving some real world problems. So when we are putting so many concepts together, the problems comes out to be very difficult to solve. With this introduction on the scope of an optimization and the properties of optimization problems, we are now moving towards the problem formulation. Now, a problem formulation look like as we have one objective called fx, and this problem is subjected to various kind of constraints. So before we start, let us see that the variable x is written as a capital X. So that's why we have written it's a multivariable function. And we also writing single objective because we have just one objective which we want to minimize it. And then we have various constraints. Now looking at the constraint which is represented by GJX having the inequality sign, and then this index J is varying from 1 to capital J. It signifies that we can have multiple inequality constraints. Similarly, if we look at the other constraint, which is hk of x equals to 0, this is the equality constraint, and the indices says that we can have multiple constraints in our problem. And the last is the variable bounds. So depending on the number of variables, so the capital N suggests that a problem can have n number of a variable. So each variable should have a variable bound. So if we put together, you can see that x is coming out to be a vector, and generally we say it's a column vector. So it consists of all the variables starting from x1 to xn. Thereafter, since we are minimizing the function, it will become the objective function for us. Then we have inequality constraint. So as we have defined, the sign here with the GJX in the problem formulation tells us that the GJ of X is the inequality constraint. Similarly, the hk of x, the looking at the sign, where left hand side equals to the right hand side, that suggests that the hk of x is the equality constraint. And xil or xiu, these are the upper and the lower bound on each variable. Now let us talk about the steps in an optimization task. So first we have to think that we need an optimization for a problem, because there are certain problems that can be solved using simulations. If we are sure, yes, we need an optimization, there is a scope of an optimization, then we go to the second step, that is called problem formulation. Now, problem formulation sometimes also referred as mathematical modeling. So, in this mathematical modeling, first we have to identify the problem parameters. As you might have realized that when we are writing some mathematical equations, those mathematical equations consist of various parameters. Some parameters are constant parameters, some parameter can change their values. So, our idea is we have to find all of these parameters. Those are the sensitive parameters will become the design variable for our problem. Thereafter, using the design variables as well as the constant parameters, we can write our objective function, we can write our constraints. Thereafter, we set up the variable bound. Now, if you look all these steps here, that is exactly what we have written in our formulation, the mathematical formulation. Say, suppose you are working in a new problem right now. So, if we are going to make such kind of a mathematical modeling or problem formulation for an optimization, it requires 50 to 60% of your effort, which is a challenging task for us. Thereafter, looking at the property of an optimization algorithm, we choose the optimization algorithm. Now, this optimization algorithm will be solving the problem and will be giving the solution. Now, if we look at the solution and if we believe that the solution is desired, we can use it. So, we can stop this process. However, if you believe that the solution is not as per our expectations, then we have to reformulate. So, as you can see, we have to reformulate and rerun. Now, looking at the figure on the right hand side, what you will realize that, say suppose the obtained solution is not desirable. So, what we are going to do is we will check the variable bounds, because it can happen that the variable bounds which we have set, the optimum solution is not lying there. So, we look on the variable bounds. So, once we set the variable bounds and we are sure, yes, there we are going to search and find the optimum solution, and still your solution is not desirable, then we want to look again the objective function as well as the constraints. And while revisiting those constraints, functions and objective functions, we can also revisit whether the chosen design variables are appropriate or not. So, what you will realize that once we are not able to get the desired solution, we have to look each and every step in the shaded region, and once we get the desired solution, then we can fix it, we can use the optimal solution for our decision making. So, let us discuss how we can decide the design variables, constraints and objective function. Now, let us begin with the design variables right now. So, our first principle is we have to find all the design variables. Now, in this design variables, a problem usually consists many design parameters. As I explained you earlier, that there are so many parameters involved. Some parameters are constant parameters, some parameters can change in the problem. So, our task is we have to list each and every parameter related to the problem. Thereafter, we look for those parameters which are sensitive to the problem. Now, sensitive means that if I am going to change that parameter, that is changing my objective function drastically. So, in this case, we are going to take only those parameters which are sensitive as design variables, and other parameters we can keep them as constant. How we can find whether this particular parameter is sensitive or not. So there is called sensitivity analysis, where we perturb that parameter value and try to find out what is the effect on objective function. Similarly, we can use the experience of a person. So someone who is working on a field or with the equipment, and they are doing the optimization manually. So we can take their experience for finding which parameter is the most sensitive for a given problem. Thereafter, we specify what type of parameter it is. So it can be binary, discrete, and real. So the each parameter means that includes the parameter as well as the decision variables. Now, based on the design variables, so the first thumb rule of an optimization problem is we have to choose as few variables as possible. It is because the efficiency and the speed of an optimization algorithm depend on the number of the chosen variable. So it says that although there will be lot of parameters, let us take only few design variables among them to construct our optimization problem, say for example objective function and constraint. Let us move to the constraints now. Now the constraints means it represents the limit on certain resources and physical phenomena. So here when we are solving a problem, we know that there is always a restriction on, or there is a some limit while we are doing that process. So for example, we can have limitation on stress, we can have restriction on current or a voltage. So those restrictions we are going to write in terms of constraints. So here our task is we have to identify what kind of a constraints we needed. So we have to note down all the constraints, because those are going to be a part of our optimization problem. So if we refer our problem formulation, you remember that we have inequality constraints and equality constraints, and we can have multiple types of inequality and equality constraints. Now let us talk about the type of inequalities. So first is called inequality constraint. So in the previously we discussed about greater than sign, but the inequality can be represented as greater than type or a smaller than type. So both type are referred as inequality constraint. Now you will be realizing that the most of the engineering problems have the inequality constraint. The other type of constraint is the equality constraint, which are generally difficult to handle. So one way to handle the equality constraint is that we can convert our equality constraint into two inequality constraint, as given in the example. Say for example, we have a deflection of the beam, say delta x is equals to 0.35. Now this equality constraint, where left hand side should be equals to the right hand side, we can convert into two inequality constraint. Say delta should be greater than and equals to 0.25, and delta should be smaller than 4.5. So that will give some such space for an optimization algorithm to look for an optimal solution. So based on the constraint, the second thumb rule in the formulation of optimization problem is that the number of complex equality constraint should be kept as low as possible. It is because you know that the equality constraints are difficult to handle, and one equality constraint, if we follow the procedure as defined here, we have to change or convert the one equality constraint into two inequality constraints. That is making too many constraints for a problem. So that's why we have to reduce these complex inequality constraint in our problem. Let us move to the objective function. Now, as you know that the objective function can be of two type. Either I will be minimizing the function or maximizing the function. How we can correlate? Say in an organization, one particular organization is looking for minimizing the cost of a product. So accordingly, they will be designing everything. But another organization may be looking for maximizing its profit. Now, both of the organization have their goal, but one is minimizing, another one is maximizing. So generally, The objective functions are written in terms of design variables and other parameters. Now, what you will realize that the algorithms generally are made using either minimization or for maximization. So, let us take an example of one particular algorithm that is designed for minimization. So, if you supply a function which you want to minimize it, this algorithm can able to give you an optimum solution. And suppose we are working for an organization where we want to maximize the profit. Now, in this situation, when we want to maximize the profit, but the algorithm is designed for minimization, can we use it? So, the answer is yes. So, which method we can use it? So, here duality principle can help us to solve such kind of issues. So, what duality principle says that, as you can see here, minimization of a function fx is equals to maximization of capital Fx, where capital Fx is equals to minus times of fx. What it says that, let us look into the figure now. So, on the right hand side, suppose I want to minimize the function fx, which is drawn in the red color. If I am going to minimize it, let's say we get the optimum solution as mentioned here. Now, if we use the duality principle, the same problem I can write as maximization of minus fx. So, what we did here is we multiplied by minus and the minimization problem is converted into the maximization. Now, let's look at the nature of the blue line, which is maximization of minus function. Now, here you can see that both of them have a different nature. Basically, they are mirror images. However, when I'm solving the problem of the blue color, I will get the same optimum solution. As you know that we are looking for an optimum solution. So, in this case, even if our algorithm is designed for minimization, we can multiply by minus 1 to the profit of the company, convert that maximization problem into minimization, solve it, then we can get an optimum solution. So, the value of the design variables, we can take those design variable and we can find what will be the our profit. And similar situation can happen if the optimization algorithm is designed for maximization. By multiplying the minimization, by multiplying minus 1 with the minimization problem, it will be converted into maximization and I can use my algorithm. Coming to the last part of the problem formulation, that is variable bounds. Now, as you can see that all the variables like x1, x2, xn, they are putting into a one vector called capital X. Now, here you can realize that whether you are solving a problem from say electrical engineering, so you have voltage, current and other things. If you are solving a mechanical problem, you can have different parameters related to the machines. So, in general, we have various input or decision variables, so we can put together and we can write in a vector form. However, for every variable, whether it is x1 or xn, all variables should have the variable bounds, which will be lying from lower to the upper one. So, once we decided it, we can have an optimization problem for our given problem. Now, as you know that up to this particular point, we can have an optimization problem generally written in the mathematical form for solving it. If we solve it, we can get an optimum solution. So, generally solving manually is not a desirable task because it is time consuming. So, what we do here is, to solving such problem, we need algorithms. Those algorithms are generally referred as optimization algorithm. So, these algorithms, so basically an optimization algorithm provides systematic and efficient ways of creating and comparing new design solutions in order to achieve an optimized design solution. So, what you can see that in every iterations, we will be creating new solutions, comparing them so that we are sure that our solution is improving and finally we will reach to the optimum solution. Now, as I mentioned earlier that manually solving such kind of a problem is not easy. So, that's why we use optimization algorithm. Since it involves creation and comparison. So optimization algorithms sometimes can be computationally expensive and will need more time to solve a problem. Now with these all the background of practical optimization problem, the applications and the generalized problem formulations for a given problem, as well as looking at the optimization algorithm, we have critical remarks on numerical optimization techniques. Why numerical optimization technique? Because once the optimization formulation is ready, we have to solve it. Now, numerical optimization can be the choice, or there are other algorithms which we can say as non-traditional optimization algorithm that we can use it. Since we will be working towards the non-traditional optimization algorithm, let's see how these numerical optimization techniques will behave. So as we know that the numerical optimization techniques, one of the method may not be applicable for a large class of a problem. It is because, for example, if our function is non-differentiable, so I cannot use those methods which needs gradient information. However, we can use some direct search methods. Constraint handling is always difficult with the numerical optimization technique. It is because it involves lot of penalty parameters. So these penalty parameters are very sensitive to our problem. So in that case, constraint handling is difficult with these kind of techniques. Now when we have a discrete variable, now discrete variable is difficult, whether it is a direct search method or a gradient based methods. So handling discrete variables are going to pose different challenges to us. Generally, numerical optimization techniques use the some mathematical rule. Based on that, they move from one point to the another point. So they find the direction in which they move. So in that case, what you will find, so generally that decision is taken with respect to the local perspective. And that local perspective may not be efficient, and we may trap the solution. We can get the solution in the local optimum. Now uncertainty, as you have seen that uncertainty in the design variable can pose lot of challenges. So that's why solving those problems with numerical optimization problem is a difficult task. Noisy and dynamic optimization problems are always difficult to solve with numerical optimization. It is because the optimization functions are keep on changing sometimes. Then we can have a problem of multi-objective optimization, where we look for multiple solutions. As we know, there could be multiple Pareto optimal solutions. So solving such kind of a problem and generating all of them will be a difficult task with the numerical optimization techniques. By looking at all the remarks here, what we can understand is we need for an innovative and a flexible optimization algorithm that should cater our need. So our need as written in terms of the remarks. So the answer to this question is we have evolutionary computation techniques that can be used for wide variety of a problem. They are direct search method. They don't need any gradient, and that's why we can use it, whether it's a discrete problem, whether it is a multi-objective problem, or there is an uncertainty, the different kind of a complexities in the problem, we can very well handle with the evolutionary computation technique. So with this introduction in this session, we can see in the later sessions and modules that evolutionary computation techniques are efficient to solve such kind of complex and large problem. With this note, I conclude the session 1 of module 1. Thank you.